Natalia Romanova Romanoff, daughter of Red Army General Ivan Romanoff, former assassin of the KGP, successfully passed the grueling training of the Red Room in Siberia, went up to rack up 30 confirmed kills, including higher value targets, such as the former US Secretary of Defense and a member of the Habsburg family. Now our organization finds fortune in having you in our fold. You have more than proven yourself. Recite the creed.
Cut off one head, two more shall grow in its place. Hail Hydra! Life gets complicated, especially in my line of work. Sometimes I wonder if it would have been better for me to run away from all of this. There were plenty of opportunities. Something held me in. That dark part deep inside me. The part that enjoys every second of it. I could have grown up to do anything. An architect designing music halls for beautiful harmonies to sing out of. Become a world-class painter and fall in love in Paris. Work in food service. But it was decided for me. I think back on how my life ended up here. My 7th birthday. Some celebration that was. It was 1999. The edge of the century and Russia lay in the crumble heap of the Soviet Union. My father, once a proud and fierce Red Army general, was reduced to office work for the government. His battlefield was no longer filled with honor, but stacks of paperwork. It hit him hard. He felt like he lost all the valor and value he had during the height of the Cold War. He was a bitter old man by the time I really started to get to know him. He saw me as a ticket to his future glory, though. He came home that day. The first sign I should have picked up on was his mood. Usually, he's erupting with rage, but this time he was almost at peace. My mother, who was typically warm and caring, was also off that day, too. She grew distant, as if feared I had the plague or something. In hindsight, this all makes sense to me, but back then, I was just an innocent, ignorant little girl.
Дочь, я рад, что ты не спишь. Ты хорошо отдохнула?
Да, сэр. Знаете ли вы, что сегодня мой день рождения?
Конечно, деточка. Как я мог забыть день рождения моей дочери?
I beam with excitement, not knowing how my father's little gift would affect my life even today.
Я собираюсь отвезти тебя в одно особенное место. Иди вперед и подожди меня в машине.
I'm about to take a step closer to my destiny when my mother finally decides to pipe in.
Ivan, you can take her there, she's only 7.
Not my Natasha, don't do this.
The girl's younger than her, already in the program. This is what she's meant to do.
To reclaim your pride? She could die.
Now listen to me, Lada.
Отец! Мать! Почему вы говорите по-английски?
Не беспокойся, просто сядь в машину, Наташ.
Like the good little girl I was, I listened to my father and waited for him in his old beat-up car left over from 40s, ignoring the shouting from back inside his house. I got used to the shouting fast, and the hitting. A day my mother didn't have a black eye was a decent day. No one would help her. They all had their own problems after the fall. I once saw a group of people beat up an old man nearly to death just because he had a loaf of bread. That's an image I'll never get out of my head. It proved to me at a young age that people will do anything to save themselves. Just like my father using me. He storms out of the house, slamming the doors hard behind him. His expression instantly transposes to a smile when he sees the look of concern on young Amy's face. I used to think he was happy to see me. Now I know that I was wrong. He hopped in his car, pulled out his wad of keys, started the car, and drove away from his house. That was the last time I ever saw it, fading slowly from the rearview mirror.
Отец, куда мы идем?
Ты увидишь очень скоро, пока помолчи, я веду машину.
I do as my father tells me. not speaking another word to him as we drive to our final destination. Moscow. We start off in the countryside, passing farmland, but gradually more structures pop up. No matter how many times I see the beautiful architect of Moscow, I'm always awestruck. Her tall, stylized vibrance always stands out to me more than any other city's buildings. I watch with wide eyes and a smile as we pass the Kremlin. We stop shortly after a plain-looking office building, faded white with very few windows. The general gets out of the car and I follow closely behind him. It must be better on the inside, I think. My father pushes the door and proves my thoughts wrong. The building is just as bland on the inside as it was on the outside. How could such a building exist in a beautiful utopia like Moscow, I wonder? Our receptionist dressed in all black at the front presses a button on her desk.
Хозяйка, генерал здесь.
The sounds of heels clatter suddenly, and a fierce-looking blonde woman in her late 40s appear in front of us. She's the heir of power, seemingly always in control of every situation she's involved in. If she walked into the middle of a battle, the fighting would cease. I take note of how my father looks at her. Perhaps some past relationship still burns within him. She gives him a smile, but not out of happiness. However, but satisfaction. The general takes her left hand and gives it a light kiss.
Mistress Belova?
Ivan, it's good to see you. Это Наташа, да?
Yes. Наташа, познакомься, это госпожа Белова. Она будет присматривать за тобой некоторое время.
Здравствуйте. Отец, что вы имеете в виду? Вы избавляете от меня? И я сделала что-то не так?
Нет, дочка, это все для тебя. Госпожа Белова сделает из тебя такую женщину, которой ты должна быть. И не ставь меня в неловкое положение своими вопросами.
That got me to shut up. I try to hold in my tears. My home life was never the best, but it was still home. I didn't want to leave, but it looked like I didn't have a choice. Mistress Belova's previous lighter expression has gone back to a dark and stern pout. Her eyes slowly scan over me, taking a step closer. She grabs my arm in an iron vice, causing me to jump.
Not very strong, is she?
Ivan shakes his head, probably feeling some shame. Out of nowhere, she slaps me hard in the face and I tumble down.
Бедняжечка ты моя.
Tears sting my eyes as I stay on the ground, fearing that I'll get slapped again.
Her training will be a fun little project. There's not much there, but she's moldable.
So, you'll take her?
Of course. We always need young blood for the program. Do you wish to say anything before we take her?
No, just make sure it only get out that she's my daughter if she's successful. I will not have this little snot destroying my reputation.
Very good. There's no need for you to be here any longer. You may go.
Without another word or even looking at me, my father walks out of the building. At this point, tears are streaming down my face and more confused and afraid than I've ever been in my life. Well, until later.
Отец!
Глупая девчонка, заткнись! Твой отец ушел.
Ты ему не нужна. Ты никогда не увидишь его больше. Понимаешь? Ты теперь будешь со мной.
I wipe the tears off my cheeks, but I still feel waves of fear crash inside me. Doing my best not to tremble, Mistress Belova grabs my wrist and drags me up to the receptionist's desk, who is typing away until Hell herself reappeared. She stands at attention right away, ready to take orders from the mistress.
Take our latest pleb down to the rail.
Да, госпожа.
I'm given no more sympathy by my new master as I'm pretty much shoved down a flight of metal stairs into a dark and dim tunnel. I'm surprised to find another young girl down there already, about my age with black hair. Her eyes shoot up to me for a second, before quickly returning to the ground when she sees the receptionist.
Если ты не откажешься от следующем поезде, я сниму шкуру с вас обеих. У меня нет времени возиться с тобой.
The receptionist sinks back to her post, knowing full well that we wouldn't dare disobey her with a threat like that. The black-haired finally looks back up from the ground and gives me the smallest smile she can manage, which given our current situation is impressive.
Привет, я Офелия.
Наташа.
Ты думаешь, она серьезна? То, что шкуру снимет?
Я бы не удивилась.
Это ужасно! Я хочу вернуться домой.
Расслабься. Я уверена, что все будет в порядке. Мой отец не отправил бы меня умирать просто так.
Как ты можешь быть такой оптимисткой? Мы понятия не имеем, куда мы идем и что они сделают с нами.
У меня нет другого выбора. Мои родители научили меня быть смелым, и это кем я буду.
А тебе не страшно?
Конечно, мне страшно.
Не похоже.
Я чувствую это внутри себя. Поверь мне. Конечно, страшно, но поверь.
Я рада, что мы вместе.
Я тоже. Страдать намного легче с кем-то, чем страдать одиноко.
Ophelia and I became fast friends. Talking about local boys we had our eyes on back home and mean teachers we struggled through. It was a nice break from the reality that we found ourselves in. But it only seemed to last mere minutes. The world screeched back to us in the form of what the mistress called the rail, an old beaten-up subway car. When it came to a full stop, the door slid open and two mean-looking women stepped out, unarmed but likely heavily trained. One motions for us to step on board, while the other watches us like a hawk. We don't show any resistance and accept their fate. I go in first. The rail's interior is poorly lit and compact. The seats were comfortable, at least, if you like cold hard metal. The trip was long and pretty quiet, though Ophelia sat next to me the entire journey. The two hawks watched us intently, as if daring us to try something. Knowing that, they'd enjoy taking us down. We don't give them the chance to. However, we behave. Ophelia keeps giving me worried expressions as the rail travels down a dark metallic tunnel. Along the way, we were given food. I say food, but it was more like leftover military rations from World War II. Better than nothing on a week trip. However, I never realized how large the world was until that day. 7 days just to get to Siberia on a train was far from the worst thing I experienced during my training. But it wasn't a great start. Ophelia and I eventually started talking, not caring what the two ever-watching guards thought. I asked her about her life before this, but she didn't give me much. Something must have happened to her. But I didn't push her for it, even though my curiosity was brimming over. After the nearly never-ending train ride, we finally reached our destination. Late at night, the rail jolted to a stop, and the two female sentries shook us rudely awake. We escorted out of the rail into a similar-looking station as the last one. The only difference being that it is freezing cold. My arms instantly shoot to my chest and I start to shiver. They give us no time to adjust as we're led up a set of stairs into another bland compound. This time a dark gray color rather than a stark white. I learned later that this was to cut down the amount of cleaning us students would have to do from the blood spit on a daily basis. Waiting in said compound is Miss Belova once again. She certainly gets around. She's not alone. All of her willing recruits dressed in all black stand at attention. None of them bothering to look at us.
Hey everyone, this is Natasha and Ophelia, our newest recruits. You all know the drill. You will not talk to them for the next month. If you are caught helping them out in any way, you know the punishment. They will be with us until further notice, so suck it up. If either of them tells you anything about their past, let me know immediately, and I will handle it personally.
This was the most confused and afraid I have ever been in my life. I had no idea what the mistress was saying. For all I know, she's telling all of her little puppets to kill me at any chance they get.
Госпожа, а где?
И не смей говорить со мной, пока ты не выучила английский. Каждый раз ты говоришь вне очереди. Ты будешь наказана.
Поняла?
Unable to say anything else, I nod my understanding. The mistress claps her hands and her minions go back to their regular schedule they've done for years. Ophelia and I are just getting started. Mistress Yelena looks at the two graduates that rode with us on the rail and nods at them. Without a second thought, Ophelia and I are separated and taken by the hand to our new living quarters. It feels like the iron grip on my hand is and will smash it into a million pieces. The woman drags me into my quarters. A closet would have been more square footage. There's a piece of cardboard down for a bed, one dim light that flickers, and a vent piping in cold air. All things considered, it's certainly better than the week train ride I endured. Plus, I can finally change my clothes. On my bed, there's a uniform waiting for me. Like the other students, it's simply an all-black shirt and matching pants. Before I can even take all this in, though, I'm shoved in by my tour guide, who proceeds to lock the metal door behind me. Looks like I'm stuck in here for a while. I have no idea what time it is, but I sleep anyways, just realizing how tired I was. I pretty much collapse down on the cardboard and use my new uniform as a blanket. I'm rudely awoken by my captor after a few hours, or what I think are a few hours. My concept of time is completely gone. Before allowing me to fully awake on my own, the door bursts open and hits me in the leg.
Come on, get up, get dressed.
I look at her confused, hardly knowing any English. That blank stare gets me another slap in the face. The first of many. If only they were just slaps. She points firmly at my pile of clothes and I nod in understanding. I pick them up and hesitant. She's still watching me. She gives me a glare and I reluctantly get changed in front of her, blushing with embarrassment. Once I've quickly gotten dressed, she takes me down to the rows of other cages. Looks like no one gets special treatment in the Red Room. All of them are empty, which means I'm late. Which also means I'm probably in trouble too. I'm taken through the seemingly maze of a compound before we stop in a large gray room. Like my own cell, the only source of light are a few dim bulbs. The dark collective makes up the black walls. All eyes on me. My heart rate quickens and my cheeks grow rosier. I spot Ophelia, however, who smiles at me and I begin to calm down. Walking to a spot next to her, I'm about to say something to her when the angle of death swoops in. Ophelia's smile fades instantly. I notice all of her palms straighten up and turn their attention to her. I mimic them, but I can feel the mistress's gaze burning on me.
Glad to see all of your smiling faces so early in the morning. We will continue to work on your hand-to-hand combat skills. Since our newest recruit was late this morning, I think it's only fair that she starts us off. Natasha, front and center.
My eyes widen at the sound of my name as Yelena motioned me forward. Like most of my first few months there in the Red Room, I had no idea what was about to happen to me. I step into the center of the room and scan around at the intimidating residents. Some of them have a cruel smile on their face, knowing what's coming next.
Ava, it's been a little bit since we've seen you in action. Prove to us all that you haven't become dull in disuse.
Yes, mistress.
She steps into the center without any hesitation, not even bothering to look at me. She's at least 2 times older than me, with well-toned muscles. She quickly ties her red hair back and nods at the mistress. Mistress Belova steps out of the center and into the shadows, but I can still see her eyes watching over us.
You may begin.
I look back at the mistress, and before I know it, I feel the sting of Ava's fist on my face. I hit the hard ground, shock filling me. Before I know it, Ava launches another blow at my chest, winding me. I see another coming and act as fast as I can, rolling out of the way. As I try to get back up on my feet, I'm kicked in the stomach. I collapse back, hitting my head and thus making my situation worse. The room starts spinning and tears obscure my vision.
Прекратите! Пожалуйста!
Ava looks back at the mistress, who walks back into the light. She nods at Ava and she returns to her space. The mistress smiles down at me. Oddly, at the time, I thought it was genuine. I hadn't gotten my naivety beaten out of me yet. She offers me a hand, and like an idiot, I take it. I'm desperate for any help in this hellhole. The mistress thankfully doesn't break my arm, but she pulls me back up on my own 2 feet.
Natasha has broken the rule. We all know what happens when the rules are broken. There are no exceptions. Let her failure be a reminder to you. Take her to the freeze. She'll be spending a week there. I know I'm being lenient, but it's only her first offense. Ophelia, Malena, you're next in the ring.
By now I'm used to being dragged off places. Part of me hoped I'd be taken to some sort of medical wing. Only later did I find out no place existed in the Red Room. I feel the air start to drop, gradually at first, but then rapidly. The handmaiden lets go of me when we reach what looks like a small vault door. She takes out a key from her belt and unlocks the door, sending out a blast of cold air and icy mist. They're literally locking me into a freezer for a week. Before I can protest, I'm jammed and locked inside. Nothing but me and my fleeting body heat. That week, I found out just how thin the uniform was. I could not feel any semblance of warmth during my time in the freezer. Fortunately, twice a day, I was let out for just a few moments to eat that day's prior stale bread. I'll never forget that wonderful feeling of warmth I felt being out of my punishment. Just the thought of it is still enough to warm me in the coldest climates. When I was finally freed, it seemed like years had gone by. I knew then that I should never accept help from anyone ever again here, and to certainly not speak Russian in the Red Room, or else it was back to the freezer. or worse. I wondered how it could get worse than that. But torture was the Red Room's specialty. And the freezer was a low-level punishment. Naturally, in the weeks after that, I started learning English and beginning my attempts at the American accent. By my second week, I was able to speak in rough fragments. I had a good reason to learn, and fortunately enough for me, the Red Room provided books for me to learn from. One of the few things they provided to their students. I was exposed to English through my lessons. Lessons on how to get information out by any means necessary. Pleasure, seduction, torture, deception. In no time at all, I became a professional liar. For a first practical assessment in that class, our teacher, Mr. Turgenov, split us up into pairs. One person was given a message to keep no matter what. The other person? Told to pry that message out of them using our lessons. The older, more advanced students were given private rooms to do so, seeing if they were ready to graduate yet. The newer captives had to do this in front of the whole class, to laughter and sneers of their other classmates. The pairing usually went boy-girl, but the teachers there saw how close I got to Ophelia in such a short amount of time, so they made an exception, knowing it would make the task a lot harder. I was anxious for weeks when Turgenov announced a date for the exam, and before I knew it, it was here. Everyone sat in the auditorium, a large and bland room with seats for everyone. Teachers assessing us right in front. Students who had passed the test previously were sometimes called up to make sure their skills were sharpened, so almost everyone was on the edge of their seat with nerves. A pair at the front just finished, the girl letting go of the information before the boy began carving to her face with the dagger.
Anatoly, though your technique was less refined, you managed to succeed. Zaraya, your ability to take punishment, however, is appalling. You will be practicing every night until you learn to last longer. If any information ever gets leaked by you in the field, you will be terminated immediately. Now, return to your seats.
The two older students take their seats, Zaraya blushing in shame at how quickly her partner got her to talk.
Natasha, Ophelia, it is your turn. May I remind the student body and our professors that these two girls are being tested for the first time. Do not let this cloud your mind with pity or soften your evaluation. You will have 30 minutes.
As we rise and walk up, I feel my legs turn into jelly. Ophelia takes a seat at the front, facing me. I scan over the interrogation tools we're provided on a table, each more terrible than the last. Everyone's watching me. I want to cry. I can't show any weakness or they'll remember it. My gaze turns to Ophelia. I can see the panic in her eyes, but she too tries to stay composed. She nods at me, gives me a small and quick smile before returning to her grim look. I'm reminded of the conversation we had a few nights before. Ophelia and I found out that our cells aren't always locked, which in itself is suspicious, and it's probably how the teachers knew we were spending more time with each other. But we were seven. We sat in my room, crammed in there, but small enough where we still had an incredibly small amount of personal space.
I have worry of exam soon.
It is only our first exam. Maybe they will be more lenient.
Lenient?
Снисходительными.
Английский трудный. Я скучаю по русскому.
Ты научишься. У тебя получается все лучше и лучше.
Thanks.
You just need to practice more.
It come easy for you. I wish I speak English freely.
Fluently. You will get there. Don't worry.
I smile at Ophelia, gaining confidence from her words of comfort. These days, they're the only words that make me feel something.
How about exam? The exam, though? What we must do is... ужасно.
It's something we have to do, Nat. You have to torture me. No matter what, you'll have to do it. Как бы я ни плакала и ни кричала, не останавливайся, продолжай меня пытать, несмотря ни на что.
My eyes turned to the ground, and I let a small tear slip from my face. The thought of torturing Ophelia? It made me sick. It made my heart hurt. Ophelia puts her hand on my chin, and I look up at her. She gently brushes away my tear, and warmly smiles at me.
Я буду в порядке.
I pass an exposed wire attached to a car battery onto Ophelia's left bicep, and her eyelids squeeze shut, teeth gritting at the pain.
Give up your information!
I do it again, allowing a tear to sting my eye. I hope that they're slightly longer.
Please, give me information and this will end.
I cannot. And I will not.
Part of me wishes that she just gave up. But I knew that if she didn't put up a fight, the results would be much worse. Instead of me torturing her, a graduate would. In my first months in the Red Room, I heard horror stories of what the graduates could do. At first, not believing anyone could do such a thing until I saw the aftermath. One of the girls in my class spoke out against the teacher and was sent away. A week later, she came back, still severely bruised and cut. I would not let that happen to Ophelia. I continued using the wires, looking back and noticing the impatient look on my evaluators' faces. I was boring them. A 7-year-old girl torturing her only friend now. And they looked ready to fall asleep. I return the wire back to its spot on the table and look at all the hideous options I have, trying to assess which would hurt the least. I take a peek at the clock. I still have 20 minutes. I look back at the table, selecting a bucket and rag. I dip the rag into the water and pull out the dripping towel. I go over to the bound Ophelia and put her head back, dangling the wet rag over her face, allowing drops of water to slip on her.
Tell me.
No!
I can't hesitate. I place the rag over her mouth, and her eyes bulge. She tries to wiggle out of my hold, but my hand is too strong. I see the panic in her eyes. She feels like she's drowning. I pull it off suddenly, allowing her to catch her breath.
Do it again.
What?
Again.
I do as she tells me, placing the towel over her mouth once again and watching in horror as she twitches and sputters. I do this a few more times. She refusing each time I stop to give the information up. I slap her a few times, hard on the face. Nothing. I'm running out of viable options on the table. Most of them would cause serious pain. I close my eyes for a second. 5 minutes. Just 5 minutes. I pick up the knife. As I walk over, I see Ophelia's breathing get heavier when she sees what I have. My hand shakes a little as I bring the knife closer to its target. She looks at me in the eyes once again, producing the smallest smile on her face momentarily. You have to do it, Natasha. Get it over with. I slide the knife quickly on her arm, not allowing it to sink too deep.
I cut you more if you don't tell me.
I do as I said I would, cutting her again on the arm. I move the knife up to her throat, but don't apply pressure. I can feel a bead of sweat drip off my face. She doesn't seem concerned. She knows whatever I do is out of necessity, and not to harm her.
What about now?
Time for the cherry on top. I punch her square in the jaw and her head jolts back. I'm getting ready for another one.
Natasha! Your interrogation skills are very rudimentary, but there is some potential there if you work at it harder. I could feel you holding back. In your time, you may have to torture not only enemies, but perhaps former friends too. If you let your feelings get in the way again, you will be schooled harder.
I bow before my judge, then I undo Ophelia's binding as quickly as I can. She rubs her wrists when they're finally free, standing up from her chair.
Ophelia, however, I must say I'm impressed by your ability to keep your lips locked. I could equate this to the lack of vigor in Natasha's torture methods. But even still, you have proven yourself. Let's see if you will continue to impress me with your interrogation tactics.
I remember every second of torturing Ophelia, but I barely remember her working on me. It was just more pain. I'd experienced a lot of that during my time in the Red Room, so it was nothing special. Fortunately for Ophelia, she did not disappoint her instructor, and we made it out with temporary wounds and not permanent crippling ones. The things these kids would do to each other, hardly older than me, it was terrifying. All the time, I couldn't imagine myself ever doing that. But it's amazing how much you'll do to just survive. The week after our interrogation exam, we were given a slight break. We weren't excused from our rigorous exercises out in the cold of Siberia, but our lessons hadn't continued yet. I spent most of my free time then learning more English and being out with Ophelia. Each night, we even had a bit of fun. Well, as much fun as future KGB assassins could have. We were shown Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs twice a night before being sent off to bed. Something was off about the movie, however. But I could never figure it out until after I was freed from the Red Room. It turned out the films were laced with subliminal messages to brainwash us. I still wonder to this day how much that movie affected me. This is the week that I finally learned how Ophelia ended up in the Red Room. It was at night, and per usual, she snuck into my room.
Careful.
Sorry! Did you see the look I got when I asked if there were any other films we could watch?
I thought for sure you would get shit beat out of you.
Where did you learn that?
Someone wrote a list of swears on one of the pages in my English book.
What other words are in it?
Here, let me show you. Son of a bitch. Turgenov is a son of a bitch.
A real bastard.
Mistress Yelena has a horse's ass.
She really does. Your English is getting better. I hardly hear you use Russian words these days.
Thanks to you.
I can't take all of the credit. I mean, look how useful that book of yours is.
Could I ask you something?
Anything.
How did you end up here?
Ophelia doesn't answer me for a moment. Staring off for a second, I start to feel bad. Like I shouldn't have asked, but then...
Red soldiers rolled into my town, demanding their tax money. The townspeople tried to explain that they had already paid for the month, and that we didn't have enough to pay again. We were all just barely living. They wouldn't listen. People started yelling, and soon the shooting began. My mother pulled me in off the street, hiding me under my parents' bed. I saw my father go into his closet and grab his old war rifle. He gave me a kiss and said, "Я люблю тебя всем сердцем." That was the last time I saw him. My parents were killed in the fight, and I was left alone. The soldiers found me and took me with them. I will never forget the bodies all over the street. I saw them all when they took me back to their base. They dropped me off at the station a week later, not wanting to feed me anymore. And now, here I am.
Tears stream out of her eyes and she puts her head down on the ground. I put my hand on her back and move in closer to her.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I should have never asked.
No. Now you know.
Those soldiers are real dickheads. Absolute damn shit-headed bastards.
She starts to compose herself, wiping away her tears. She pushes herself on the ground, and we end up staring at each other in silence for a moment. Before I knew it, Ophelia gives me a quick kiss on the lips. It was there and gone just like that. I feel my own face grow very red, as I sees hers too. My heart beats faster.
Sorry. I shouldn't have done that.
I
should go before we're caught. I'll talk to you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.
I thought about the kiss for the rest of the night, unable to sleep. It still quivered on my lips and I couldn't stop wondering what it meant. Was it an accident? Or was it something else? It was an answer I didn't get for a while. We went on pretending it didn't happen as our new lessons arrived.
Besides your bodies, this is one of your most useful weapons. It gives you power over others and can often be used as a tool for bargaining. Just possessing one of these puts you ahead of most of the people around you out in the field. Before you use it, you must know it. To not know your own weapon is to die by it. You will be disassembling your pistol as many times as it takes to permanently sink in. Should you fail this next exam, the pistol will be used against you. If you don't believe I would ever dare, ask a graduate Anna.
There were no idle threats in the Red Room. The graduate Constantin was referring to was missing an ear. And though I never knew just how it happened, I was certain it happened here. This confirms it. With that promise, everyone in my class began studying, working on their pistols. I spent hours and hours practicing reassembling and disassembling my pistol more times than I can count. Each night when Ophelia and I met, we brought them with us and trained.
You're too good at this! I don't understand how you do it!
Just don't think about it. Let it happen. Here, watch my hands.
I take apart my gun without looking, letting it happen naturally. Soon, without much thought, it's done.
How the hell? You have to be magic!
Take it slow and work up to it. Let me help you.
Ophelia sets her firearm down and puts her hand on it. I lightly place my hands on hers, and they jolt.
Sorry. I'll guide your hand through the motions.
Your hands are soft.
I remember blushing a little at that remark. After a lot of practice, we passed our exams with flying colors. But our next lesson wouldn't be so easy. As the years progressed, I started becoming what they were trying to make me. A cult killer who wouldn't hesitate at any crossroad. I began changing into a woman, growing stronger and beginning to care less about others. My teachers noticed how far I sunk in, sometimes even giving me praise, especially my hand-to-hand combat trainer. I was punching at a large girl a few years older than me, ignoring the bruises on my hand as blood dripped all over them.
Keep it going! Don't stop until I say!
The girl I was fighting can barely stand now, trying to dodge my attacks but failing. Hit after hit, the floor grew redder as I didn't relent.
Please, stop.
I block out her pleas, throwing one last punch. She's out.
You're getting there, Natasha. You've got a lot of promise. If the world of espionage and assassination doesn't work out, perhaps you have a future as a boxer.
I was living with two sides now, harsh and cold in the red room, but my ordinary human self for Ophelia. Naturally, the one that I gave mercy to was Ophelia. She was the one person I bothered to talk to. She was literally the only person I had in the world. I couldn't even tell you a quarter of the names of the people who were in my class. I was ashamed of my monstrous side when she saw it, but it had to be done if I wished to stay with her. The courses got harder, more brutal interrogations, more physical challenges, and a lot more pain. I distanced myself from Ophelia during lessons, hoping the mistress and her harsh teachers wouldn't use her against me. I knew that would only delay the inevitable, but at this point, I would have given up my life for her. There was something about her. Perhaps it was the forbidden kiss, or the hope for the future she inspired. But my thoughts dwelled on her the most. She was my only escape from the punishment I continued to live in for what seemed like a century. When I was 11 years old, I had only 3 years left until graduation. H has some perks. Now that my class is older, we're given larger rooms and a better bed. But anything would have been better than a sheet of cardboard. The room finally deemed us ready to use our guns too. I suspected that they wanted to make sure that we were loyal enough to not use them on our superiors. But I was surprised, we didn't learn sooner. By 14, my graduation year, I was a perfect shot.
Not a single miss, Natasha. Remember, a marksman doesn't practice until they've got it right. But when they never get it wrong. I will allow you all to leave my class early, knowing that you will continue training alone for your examinations. In case you've forgotten already, these exams will decide your fate. If you fail them, it will be your lives. We won't give you mercy in the end either, so remember that and train hard. Don't give me the satisfaction of ripping the pitiful lives out of your puny bodies. Dismissed.
I didn't get much sleep in those weeks before the exams, for obvious reasons. I wasn't so worried about myself as I was worried about Ophelia. She was good, but she still had skills that needed refining.
Come in, Ophelia.
I was trying my best to relax in my room, alone, with the dark abyss of my thoughts. But I climbed out of them quick when Ophelia arrived.
How did you know it was me?
Who else has the courtesy to knock around here?
Too true.
Did you get some practice in?
I just got back from the range. I think I'm improving.
Have you been using that trick I taught you?
Of course. How else do you think I'm getting better?
Ophelia plops down next to me on my bed.
How much sleep have you been getting? You always look like you're about to collapse.
I can say the same about you.
I think the last time I got a good night's sleep was when I was 6. You need to be at your best for the exams, though. Either you start sleeping better, or I'll knock you out myself.
Oh, you can try.
Ophelia launches at me, knocking me over on my bed. We play fight for a moment, wrestling around and trying to throw one another's grips on the other. I almost accidentally kicked her off my bed, but she doesn't seem to mind, jumping back in her place. Somehow we both ended up stopping, Ophelia holding herself above me. We looked into each other's eyes, and time stands still. For a moment, my mind thinks about Ophelia and how beautiful she looks. Her beautiful dark umber hair dances on my face, her warm brown eyes staring into mine, and her sweet smile shining as bright as ever. She slowly lowers herself down on me, and I instinctively place my hand on her back, drawing her in close. I feel her body pressed closely against mine as she gives me a kiss. My heart stops, feeling fireworks on my lips. I sense myself filled with passion and I let myself go. We missed dinner that night, but I don't think anyone noticed or really cared. I spent that night in her arms, enjoying every minute of it. It was the first time in my life I truly felt in love.
I wish I could spend the rest of my life right here.
That's not enough time. I wish I could spend forever here.
Ugh, that's so cheesy.
But you liked it, didn't you?
You got me there. It's amazing how long we've been here. Feels like decades.
I know what you mean. I hardly remember anything that happened on the outside.
How would our younger selves feel about us now?
They'd probably see us as monsters.
Do you ever feel guilty about everything you have to do here?
Only when I hurt you. Why? Do you?
Every time, yes. Especially when it's you. I just don't know how you do it. It's like...
I turn on a switch and lose my humanity.
I wouldn't put it like that exactly.
But I would. They did this to me and I accepted it. I don't feel anything when I do their bidding. That's why I need you. You keep me from descending into the void. Too cheesy?
No. That was perfect. I should go back to my room before someone finds us.
Ophelia slides out of my bed and gets dressed again. I start feeling cold loneliness sweep over me as she heads for the door.
I love you.
She stops in her tracks and doesn't say anything. I start panicking right away. Did I rush into things? Was that the wrong thing to say? Ophelia turns around with a large grin. All of my worries disappear.
I love you too. See you bright and early tomorrow.
It took a while for the smile plastered on my face to fade. I felt pure bliss and hopeful for once in a long time. I'd forgotten where I was, but it didn't take long for me to be reminded. I drifted peacefully to sleep, content, knowing I would see Ophelia in the morning. Except I didn't. I was surprised to find her nowhere in my 3 a.m. interrogation class, nor during my firearms practice. I kept my composure, but deep inside, I'm in full panic mode. I wanted to ask someone. Anybody. I would even ask Mistress Belova, not caring what she would do to me. I wanted to scream, but I knew I couldn't. Instead, I stewed and waited impatiently, trying not to consider the worst outcome. But that wasn't easy. I lost my focus completely in the next week Ophelia was taken.
Come on, Natasha! You're letting your guard down! Focus!
I hit the ground hard and blood started gushing from my nose. My opponent is about to hit me again, but I roll out of the way just in time. Her fist makes contact with the hard concrete floor. I act quick, sweeping her legs with mine, sending her tumbling. I get back up on my feet and kick her in the ribs a few times.
You're pathetic. Go to the back. You're lucky I don't throw you into the freezer for that shit. Next!
That night I cried myself to sleep. It had been so long since I allowed myself to feel the sting of hot tears. But I couldn't barely take it anymore. That was one of my lowest points. I wanted to die. I almost took my pistol and ended it that night. It would have been so simple. One bullet straight to the heart, and I'd be done. I held the cold weapon against my chest even. I'm glad I didn't pull that trigger. I spent the week feeling incredibly alone. More alone than I ever felt. It was like a piece of myself was gone, and I couldn't obtain a shred of happiness. A few days after that night in my melee class, Ophelia finally turned up. I control myself when she walks into the room, but I nearly cut myself while I sharpened my knife at the surprise and sudden feeling of joy. I'm relieved to see she's still alive, but horrified at the state she's in. She has a slight lip, scratches on her face, and I'm sure much more damage hidden away under her clothing. She doesn't smile at me, or pays me much mind at all. Instead, she limps over to the spot next to me. My joy diminishes, worried that I'm to blame for her relentless torture, that our new relationship burned her. Then, her hand brushes against mine briefly, but purposefully. My worries leave. I had an equally hard time concentrating on our lesson. I was boiling over with questions. Ophelia gave me a look that said later, reading what I was feeling well. Later seemed like ages, having to attend classes until 7 p.m. that night. There were several points where I almost spoke out and let my volley of questions out, but doing so would have meant more punishments for Ophelia and me. Not that I cared if I were punished, just Ophelia. At last, night fell upon the compound and Ophelia did her typical sneaking into my room ritual. My heart was pounding hard when the door opened. I get out of my bed and rush over to her, giving her a long hug.
Oh, thank God. I was so worried. I thought they killed you. I couldn't stop blaming myself, thinking that what we did was the cause of your suffering. I could barely function while you were gone.
You were crushing me.
Sorry.
There are worse methods of torture.
I stop hugging her and take a seat on my bed. Ophelia follows suit.
Was what we did?
No. They never mentioned you during our sessions. Either they don't know or are saving that little secret.
Well, at least that's something. What happened to you?
They thought I was weak and wouldn't pass my examination, so they wanted to expedite my inevitable execution by trying to break me. I didn't break. They threw me in the freezer, carved me up, starved me, waterboarded me, electrocuted me, nearly cut my eye out. Nothing got to me.
Ophelia puts her hand lightly on mine and looks into my eyes.
All I thought about was you. You gave me strength. I fought for my life, knowing that if I made it, I would see you again.
Ophelia leans in and gives me a light kiss. Though she's battered and bruised, her lips still taste sweet.
We'll make it through this, all of this, and we'll do it together.
Not even the Red Room can break us up.
That was the most joy I've ever experienced. Having Ophelia back at last and knowing that though we were deep in the abyss for now, we had each other, and we would rise out. It's too late to win unscathed, but all that mattered was we were together. We inspired each other to try harder, to beat the Red Room at its own game. We wouldn't become what they wanted us to be. We'd be better, more lethal, more intelligent than any of our teachers. Better than Mistress Belova was in her prime. Time ticked faster with Ophelia back, and eventually, it was time for our graduation exams. I didn't know what to expect. Sure, we were told what might be on it, but there was no certainty. They wanted to keep us on our toes because out in the field, the situation could change in a blink of an eye. The day before, Mistress Belova told all the potential graduates to meet her in the main hall at 5 in the morning. I should have known that was a lie. My door burst open hours before decided meeting time, and I jolt awake. Before I can react, a felt bag covers my head, and I'm dragged out of bed. I try to break free of my captors, but no success. My hands flail around, desperately, attempting to grab anything. My hands slap a metal railing. I know where we are. The ballet room. I grab a hold of the bar and swing myself up, managing to hit one of my captors with my leg. I feel a tight grip on my arms release and I act fast. I rip the bag off my head and take in my surroundings. The room is nearly pitch black, just one dim bulb shining light on us. In front of me are two masked women, already reacting to my attack. One launches a kick at my head while the other aims for my legs. I roll to my left, the leaping woman landing down gracefully next to me. I fire a kick at her, but she grabs my leg and twists. I use all my might and break free of her hold as the other woman tries to grab my waist. I quickly elbow her a few times in the chest and stomach, and she's winded. I focus my attention back on the other opponent. She throws a few punches at me, but I block them. I'm not quick enough to get them all, though. One hits me square in the face and my vision blurs. I concentrate to the best of my ability, but while I adjust it, I feel a few more punches smash into my side. After feeling a third, I grab the owner's hand and pull her closer. I throw my palm at her nose, feeling it break on contact, before she can launch a counterattack. I swipe her legs and she tumbles. I bend over her, grabbing her neck, and slam the back of her head against the back of the wall a few times before letting her fall back limp. For a brief moment, I thought I won that sparring match. But then I remember. My other adversary reminds me that she's still alive and well, her arm like a boa constrictor around my neck. I slam myself down on her and try to pry her off. I use my elbows again and jab her into her ribs. She's tougher than the other graduates, however, and works through the pain. I feel myself begin to grow faint as my air supply slips away from me. I elbow her harder and harder, but she will not let go. Rage boils over in me, and I whip myself up and slam back down on her as hard as I could. Her vise hold slips off of me, finally.
Seriously? It takes two opponents to win you. Well then, I'm afraid it looks like your time is numbered. Tick. Tock.
The light flickers on and I realize that I'm hardly alone anymore. Surrounding me and moving in are about 15 more dominoes to topple. I pick myself off the floor. No time to beat around the bush. Everyone gets in their fighting stance and I begin. Sweeping my leg up the throng, I manage to knock a few down with that trick, but it runs its course fast. One woman jumps out of the way of my leg and kicks me in the head. I hit the floor once again, and instantly feeling fists cascade down on me from all angles. I start to feel numb from all the pain, trying to think of a solution fast. Cold blood begins leaking from my nose, and my bones feel ready to break. I could get anything I can, not aiming with any precision. I push back a few of my foes, and I take a window of opportunity, scrambling up to my feet and running away with a limp.
Afraid of your own fate, are you? There's only so far you can run before the end engulfs you.
I hear the swarm gaining on me. Mistress Belova was right. It was only a matter of a few short moments before they caught up to me. It didn't matter, however. I reached my destination. I go to the back of the combat training room and select two wooden pack as billy clubs from the rack and turn back to the entrance, just in time to see my remaining adversaries. I whip the weapons around with all my might and dispatch a few more enemies with knocks of the head. One of the assassins attempts to grab both of my billy clubs, but only gets her hand on one. I lash out at her hand, and hearing a sickening crunch when my other club makes contact, she lets go, and I kick her back away from the rest of us. Six remaining. I wipe the sweat off my brow and get back to it. A woman behind me gets a few jabs at my ribs before I hit her arm and wreck her knee. The combo distracts her a moment as she nearly falls back. I finished her off with two hard blows to the jaw. Another woman tries to latch onto my throat from my back, but I stab down at her feet, whip around, and crash my billy club into her stomach. I get one last hit on her before she can block it, sending her careening into the next fighter. She's shoved aside as the four still upright encircle me. I try to hit one of my weapon, but she grabs it and slams it into my face without a second notice. I keep my mind footing and jump at her, pinning her down. I try again to throw another punch at her, but she rolls out from under me and twists my leg. I feel drained and beaten. I just want this to be over. Two women scoop me off the floor and hold me against the wall. The other remaining hit woman lay into me, punching me as hard as they possibly can all over. My legs are practically broken at this point, but I have no other option. I swing my leg up and push one woman away from me. The other tries to grab my leg, but I put it down as fast as it was up. I break away out of my human handcuffs right before a fist hits my head. Thank goodness, too. That probably would have been a knockout blow. Her hand smacks against the wall, and I slid behind her and crush the rest of her body into it. I punch a warrior's head on the ground, just as she aims to get back up and into the fight. Two more. Wait. One more. The other ran off. I dodge a punch and give one back, but it doesn't do much. Another sails at me and I dodge, but too slowly. I act like the punch did more damage than it really did, allowing myself to slump back on the floor. The woman bends down and picks me up by the collar, a hyena smile on her face. She readies her fist, preparing to knock me out when I knee her in the crotch suddenly. Her eyes bulge in pain, and a tear slips out of her eye. I hit her knees next, causing them to buckle, and send her falling back. She's out when her head hits the hard concrete ground.
Shit.
Yet again, I lift myself off the ground and start to shakily walk out of the training room. I don't get too far when I found out what happened to the graduate that ran off. She stands there, waiting for me in the hallway, knife drawn. Looks like the battle's not over just yet. She gives me an evil smile before dashing at me. I stand my ground, trying to conserve as much energy as I can for the fight ahead. She slices at my knee, but I duck down just in time. I kick at her legs, but she already knew I would do that, moving out of the way. I try to punch her and get the knife out of play, but instead I got a fresh cut on my arm. I narrowly dodge a second knife slash. I grab her knife hand but get bombarded with her left fist in the process. I kick her hip, but she takes advantage of that moment, taking my leg and stabs me in the thigh with her knife. As painful as it is, I too use that to my advantage. Pulling my leg back and pulling the knife out, that bitch's eyes widen. It's my turn. She acted like she was the best of the bunch, but it was just that, an act. With one fluid movement, I swipe the knife across her legs, and she plummets instantly.
I can't deny, I'm impressed you didn't die. And yet, disappointed too. I will allow you to take a small break before your next challenge. Use it wisely.
I feel utterly beat and drained, having a hard time walking back to my room. I wish I could just give up, but knowing that would mean my death, I knew I had to keep fighting. It wasn't my life I was concerned about. In all honesty, I wouldn't care if I lived or died without Ophelia. But she was my reason. I finally made it back to my room, thankfully to find no one was waiting to kill me in there. I pull out my medical kit and begin to patch up all my cuts. It's not long before I can return to my examination. I half expected it to be Ophelia, but that doesn't seem likely. My door swings open and Mistress Belova steps in.
Ready for your next challenge?
I get up off my bed, still limping slightly as I follow Mistress Belova to the next portion of the exam. If I have to fight anymore for graduates, I may as well call it quits now. The pain is starting to get to me. Slowly, I walk through the empty hallways. Well, not empty from the mess I made earlier, but void of life. She stops in front of the blank white doors and motions for me to step forward. Without saying another word, she starts walking away. I pull open the door, and I'm not surprised to find a woman tied to a chair and a table of interrogation weapons. But what does surprise me is that she's not Ophelia. Is the Red Room taking it easy on me? Highly uncharacteristic. She screams for hours before I finally get what I need. When I open the door, Mistress Belova is waiting there with a simper on her face.
Your interrogation techniques have certainly been refined over the years. I'm almost impressed. Almost. For your final test, a test of your loyalty and conviction. You'll be performing this in front of the entirety of the Red Room.
She takes out a pistol from her holster and hands it to me.
You will need this.
I take it, knowing fully well that I was about to kill someone. I've tortured many people in my days of training, but never have I actually murdered someone. Would I be able to do it? I don't have a choice, it's me or them. I just wonder who them is. I won't have to wait too long. Mistress Belova starts walking me towards my destiny, the true crossroad of my life. We enter the auditorium. Miss Belova wasn't kidding. Everyone from the Red Room was there. Teachers, students, graduates, even a few people I'd never seen before. All there just to watch me. Mistress Belova leaves me to take my stage as she finds her place with the other teachers. I look around as I climb the small stairs up to my big moment. I spot Ophelia in the mob, a little scruffed up, probably from her graduation challenge like me, but otherwise looking well. She gives me a small smile and I return it. My attention leaves my audience and locks into my target, a man tied up against a pole with a bag over his head. I look to Mistress Belova and she motions me to take off his hood. I nod and step towards the man. My hand grips the rough canvas bag and rip it off. To my shock, the man before is my father.
Dochka.
His face and tone tells me he's surprised to see me as I am. I feel a wave of mixed emotions. Confusion, rage for what he had let happen to me, and oddly a small bit of contentness. But I can't tell if it's from seeing a familiar face or from my imminent revenge. Probably the latter. The man who never loved me, sent me off to become the monster I am now. Getting killed by that very monster.
Natasha, look how you have grown. You've become a beautiful young woman.
That's what happens when you abandon me for nearly a decade.
I did it for your own good. Surely you can see that now. You've become the person you were meant to be.
I've become a demon I never wanted to be.
Natasha, please. Perhaps I make a mistake. Tell them how important I can be. Spare me.
This will complete my training. I thought that's what you wanted.
The way I see is your training is complete. I will speak with Yelena. I can end this. I love you, Dochka.
You don't love anything.
The room is completely quiet. My father's blood began to stain the floor, the liquid flowing from his lifeless body. I don't feel a shred of sorrow, only the residue of the anger I felt towards him. I had my first kill under my belt, the first of many. They never haunted me. I never saw any of their faces in my darkest nightmares. Not even my father's. Mistress Belova stepped up to the stage, with the closest thing I've ever seen to a genuine smile on her face.
It brings me pleasure to announce that Natalia Alyanovna Romanoff has officially passed her examination and is now a full-fledged graduate. She will continue the long-lasting legacy of the Red Room wherever she travels. No more shall she bear the name Natalia. She lives on now as the Black Widow. To the Black Widow!
Instead of an applause, the room stands and gives me a salute. I almost feel a sense of pride for my actions in that moment. Later in the day, Ophelia passed her examination too, having to kill a soldier that rescued her from the old village. She didn't hesitate either. She officially became Viper that day. Naturally, Mistress Belova had noticed how close Ophelia and I had gotten, so she made us a team, and soon, we got our first mission.
The Habsburgs have been pulling strings from under the table for far too long. It's time they learned Russia's might. No one messes with the Red Room and gets away with it. Your target, Maximilian Habsburg. Kill him by any means necessary, but under no circumstances are you to get caught. If you do, you expected to take your cyanide capsule. He's currently meeting with high-ranking officials in the Casino de Monte Carlo. Security will be tight, but you were trained for this. Any questions? You know what to do.
The Casino de Monte Carlo was unlike anything I'd ever seen, even more so at night. The casino looked more like a palace, and all the guests were treated like kings and queens. Expensive cars lined the parking lot. People dressed like royals paraded their wealth inside, some gaining even more while others lost significantly. We spent a week scouting out and learning everything we could about the place, devising a plan on how to take down Maximilian. All of our hard work in the Red Room paid off, and now I was actually having fun. Ophelia and I spent a lot of time together, staying up late on stakeouts and waking up early to revise the plan. Friday rolled around and it was time. We were given fake IDs from the Red Room in order to get us into the High Roller Room, where Maximilian had already spent a few long nights in racking up chips. I dyed my hair a dark brown and wore blue contacts while Ophelia bleached hers and wore brown contacts. Both of us slipped on tight dresses to get Royal's attention, mine a deep scarlet and Ophelia's a sharp emerald. I felt eyes linger on us as we passed through the public area on our way to the High Roller section. I continue taking note of all the guards as they pass my peripheral vision, and I keep count. So far, there are no surprises. Everything goes smoothly so far, but we're just at the beginning. We make it to the two bouncers blocking off the elite's portion of the casino, but don't even bother showing our IDs to them.
Back again tonight, Miss Watson? Miss Rivera?
Naturally, Javier. Wouldn't want to miss a minute of the action.
You actually playing tonight?
A ditz like me? Please. I can't even do sales tax in my head. Natalie over here's up to bat, though.
She any good?
Absolutely terrible. But the boys can't keep their eyes off her. Gives her an edge. They take pity on a pretty little thing like her, too.
Well, don't let me stop you.
The bouncer steps out of the way and lets us pass. Both of us give him face grins as we enter the grand elite room. The front lobby is glamorous, but this takes it to a whole new level. The chandeliers are adorned with real diamonds. The red carpet is probably made from silk. The light fixture is made of pure gold. and the finest card game table spread around the place, with the main attraction in the center. Bingo. Well, poker. Do you really think I'm that bad at poker?
There's a good reason you're doing this part. You don't actually have to play.
Ornately dressed men and women all sit around the table, and we spot our guy. Maximilian Habsburg sits at the front of the table, looking intently at his cards and making a face. Must be a bad hand. His long brown hair is pushed away from his face, and he currently wears a red suit with a black boonier pinned on his lapel.
I fold.
His cards hit the table with a light thud. He's clearly upset that he lost. As per the plan, I begin making my way towards him, sinking over to get his attention. It works too. His eyes wander over me and I give him a sly smile. He returns the smile and motions me over to him. I act all innocent and point to myself. Nothing. Me? And he nods with a wink. I allow myself to blush, walk up behind him. I slid my hands along his shoulders and stand to his side.
You've been here every night, haven't you?
Why? You've been stalking me?
You've caught my eye, yes. You're very beautiful. Like a Greek goddess.
I'm sure you say that to all the waitresses.
If you're a waitress, I'd like you to take my order.
And what will you be having this evening? An hour later, we're back at his hotel room. He taps his key card, and the door clicks open. Naturally, the interior looks nicer than half the houses in my old village. There's literally a small chandelier in his room. I don't get to look around too much, though, as Maximilian doesn't waste any time. He presses me against the wall, kissing me deeply. I feel his hand creeping up my thigh, but I stop it. I lightly push his face away from mine and stroke his cheek. Give me a minute to make myself look pretty.
You don't need it.
He tries to lean in to resume his kisses, but I block him again with my hand. Go make yourself comfortable. I'll be right out. I give him a light kiss on the cheek before brushing past him and heading into the bathroom. People don't think straight when they have sex on their mind. Inviting a complete stranger to your hotel room is never a good idea. You can get robbed. Or in this rich prick's case, murdered. I slid a few pills out of secret compartment in my skirt and set them by the sink. I reach into my purse and grab my spare all-black clothes and change as fast as I can. I pack my dress into my bag, scan the room for any loose hairs I may have left behind, and prepare myself for my second kill. Let's do this. I open up the door, but don't step out yet. Close your eyes. Are they closed?
Yes. Now stop being a tease and get out here.
I walk out of the bathroom and find a shirtless Maximilian laying back on his bed, keeping his word with his eyes closed shut. I walk over slowly, so I don't alarm him, and hop up on the bed. I see a smile rise on his face as I move on top of him. I press one of my hands over his eyes and stroke his cheek with my other, feeling his light stubble brush against my palm. I slide a finger on his upper lip before jamming the pill into his mouth. He swallows without hesitation, perhaps thinking they'll increase his enjoyment. In reality, his enjoyment's about to be cut short. He suddenly starts to freak out, flailing wildly and trying to push me off. I stay on him as long as I can, but he flips me off the bed and tries to stand up. His legs fail him and he crashes back down on the bed.
Yo!
His mouth starts foaming as his eyes bulge in fear. He stops breathing. I stare at his lifeless body for a moment, almost amused to see this rich prick no longer contributing to any air pollution from his alcohol-laced breath.
Room service!
Right on cue. I open the door to see Ophelia's smiling face, dressed up in a dapper red hotel uniform and pushing a cart.
You ordered the creme brulee, right?
Just get in here and help me with the garbage.
Yes, ma'am.
As per our plan, Ophelia stuffs the body under the tarp on her food service cart with my help. She'll take it down to the basement and dispose of Maximilian in the trash chute. Sure, his body will be found eventually, but we hope by then he'll be rotting and contaminated with all the other trash. When she leaves with the deceased Maximilian, I open the window on the back wall and let the night wind drift in. I carefully climb out and close the window behind me. My fingers grip the rough brick and gradually move over to a column. I wrap my arms around it and slide down when I make sure the coast is clear. My first mission was in the bag. Everything went surprisingly well. Our teamwork abilities only grew from there. Mistress Belova put us on more and more challenging missions after each success. We always had each other's backs too. There were several times on jobs where I could have died if it weren't for Ophelia. I saved her a fair amount too. In Belgrade, she saved me from a sniper.
Get down!
I returned the favor by saving her in a vignon. Her eyes were locked in on her target, a duchess from Denmark, when one of her guards tried to sneak up and take out Viper before she got the shot off. Luckily enough, I saw him before he pulled the trigger. I tossed a throwing knife at him as fast as I could. It buried itself in his skull, and he hit the ground hard.
Holy shit! Thanks for that.
Our lives had become a dance of death, neither of us falling onto oblivion because the other was there to stop the Angel of Death from taking the other victim. Our series of successes seemed to never end, but sadly, everything has an end. A tragic screeching halt was bound to happen in our dangerous line of work. It was in a car chase in Sorrento. Our target, an ex-Red Room graduate, spotted us before we took her out and ran. Ophelia and I quickly ran after her, not wanting this mission to be our first failure. Our hit stole a car and hotwired it fast. The blue sports car zipped off, but not out of sight. Ophelia steals a black Ferrari parked outside of a small cafe and I hop in. She doesn't squander any valuable time since hotwiring was one of the skills the Red Room taught us. The misappropriated car starts with a roar and we're off on a pursuit. It doesn't take long for Ophelia to catch up to her mark.
Keep it steady!
I've got it!
I aim my pistol at the driver's seat of the car, and I'm about to fire off a shot when something slams into her car. I look for its source and see a motorcyclist dressed in leather right next to us. My eyes shoot to the rearview mirror as more come out from the alleyway.
Who the hell invited these goons?
Watch out!
I grab Ophelia's neck and push her down just as a few bullets smash into her windshield. I shoot off a few shots at her shooter, and one of them hits its mark, sending the driver flying. We're not out of the fire yet, however, as more bikes start gaining on us. Ophelia has the initiative to swerve into them. One moves out of the way, but the other gets shoved off the vehicle. I let a few more bullets fly, attempting to hit the last remaining motorcyclist. But I just break her rear window more.
Could you have possibly chosen a louder gun?
I suddenly have an idea and act on it right away, hopping to the back of the car and brushing away the remaining shards of glass from the window.
What the hell are you doing back there?
Don't worry about it, just keep driving!
I carefully take aim, and without a second thought launch out of the open window, landing perfectly on the last motorcycle. Any sooner or later, I would have painted the street. I wrap my leg around the driver and shove him off before he can pull out his knife. I grab hold of the motorcycle and zip after my target. A fresh breeze from the Gulf of Naples whips by as I gain on her car. More bullets fly at me, this time from her car. They smack down hard on the road close to me, but none of them hit the bike. I look back at Ophelia and give her the motion to head to the right, already course correcting. I gain faster on her, taking the left and drawing closer to our enemy's window. We're both in sync, pulling up to the cab of the target's car simultaneously. I carefully grab my gun and try to shoot at her. But the worst happens. She slams hard into Ophelia's car, and it breaks the car railing and spins off into the sea below.
No!
I skid the bike to a halt immediately. Not even the slightest bit concerned with her head anymore. All that matters is Ophelia. I let the motorcycle fall down, and I rush to the edge of the road, diving into the water after her. My body slams down roughly into the gulf, and warm water surrounding me as I frantically swim around towards the ever-sinking crunched car. I see Ophelia struggling to get out of the car, hitting the windshield as hard as she can, but it holds up. I try to swim in to pull her out through the back window, but it's too bent out of shape for me to squeeze in. I head back to the front of the car and grab my pistol, slamming it into the glass. Light cracks start forming. It's working. Bubbles start escaping from Ophelia's mouth. Come on, hang in there! She presses her hand up against the glass, and I keep hitting the windshield as hard as I can, beginning to run out of oxygen myself. I faintly see her pointing to me and then pointing up. She wants me to leave. No, I can't. I won't leave her! I shake my head furiously, but she calmly nods. I start choking on the water. She knocks on the windshield, stubbornly telling me to leave. With great effort, I go back up to the surface. I go back down as quickly as I can after the breath of fresh air, noticing the car slipping to the bottom. With all my might, I plunge down to it fast. But Ophelia stopped trying to break free. She's gone. I'd have given everything to switch places. It should have been me that died that day. I was harshly reprimanded by Mistress Belova for my failure. She beat me near to death. I wish she went further. My happiness died with Ophelia, as did my humanity. I sunk deep into my work, not feeling anything for any of my targets or anyone in my life. I'd shut myself off completely from my emotions. The ecstasy of smile, the hot sting of tears, the fear of embarrassment, the violent eruption of anger. All of it just vanished.
Blue Hotel. Life don't work out my way.
So, Miss Robinson, why exactly do you want to be a maid?
I don't mind cleaning, and I need some extra cash.
We can only pay you $8 an hour for now, but if you stick around, we'll bump it up to $10. You can work Fridays and Saturdays?
I've got nothing better to do.
Perfect. You can start tonight at 5. Our head maid, Wusi, will show you the ropes.
2018. 4 years to the date of when I lost Ophelia, and my life hadn't changed. Miss Belova tried to find me a new partner. I let her die on a mission. Getting close to someone is hard, so I didn't bother. I now find myself leaving a cheap hotel 8, embedding myself as a maid to get my next target. He was the head of some private spy organization based in America. Undercover now was a name by the name of Philip Stanton. Guess he thought he was being clever, hiding in such an inconspicuous location. But the Red Room was more clever. We intercepted an intelligence report saying he'd be arriving at the hotel a week from Tuesday. So this hit woman spent her days and nights as a maid, cleaning rooms, changing sheets, and washing blankets, while familiarizing myself with the hotel layout and forming a kill plan. All this was second nature. Soon enough, my plan was ready. Just in time, too. I watch as the front door slides open, and a man, African-American in his mid-40s, with a distinctive eye patch, walks in coolly.
Good evening. How are you?
Just fine, thanks. I have a reservation.
All right. And what name is it under?
Philip Stanton.
Okay. Ah, here we are. Stanton, 4 nights, yes?
Right.
Very good. Here's your key, room 213. The Wi-Fi code's in the back, and breakfast is at 6:30 to 9. Have a wonderful stay.
Thanks.
Stanton pockets his keys, picks up his bags, and heads towards the elevator. He nods at me as he passes by me.
Ma'am?
Enjoy your stay. While he can, I watch him as he gradually fades out of view. He looks strong enough, but besides that intimidating eye patch, pretty ordinary. Never judge a target by their body strength, I was taught. For all I know, he could be a genius, having at least 15 different methods on how to take out everyone he sees in his head at all times. My first night would simply be observing him, whenever I can without drawing attention to myself. The second night will be his demise. I can't afford to fail again. I spent my night hard at work fixing up rooms. Someone spilled soda all over the carpet. That was real fun. Sure beats a week in the freezer, though. I go down to the dining area for a quick bite. Smells like it's chicken again. I spot Stanton, but I don't make a fuss. I pretend he isn't even there. I can feel his eyes well on me. Does he suspect something? He's the head of an espionage bureau. Of course he does. He probably ripped apart his room in search of bugs first thing when he got in. To be fair, I do the same. I sit away from him, focusing on my dinner, but also sneaking a few good looks at him. He looks like the type of person that wouldn't even smile on his birthday. Which I can relate to. I haven't celebrated that since I was 7, and I'm still living with that present. Suddenly he gets up, throws away his trash, and walks out. His all-seeing eye lingers on me, before he's obscured by the wall. Some ladies might be flattered by a flirtatious stare, but this was far from amorous. He couldn't recognize me, could he? Perhaps it's time to push my plan forward. After waiting a moment to give Stan time to get back to his room, I make my way to what I hope will be his funeral. I quickly head to my locker in the staff room, making sure no one sees me pull out my small Beretta Pico and put it in my pocket. I check to see if my master key is still on me and get to work. I hurriedly climb the stairs, fearing that Stanton is already on his way out, possibly getting a whiff of what I'm attempting already.
Hey, Jane, where are you off to in such a hurry?
Cleaning emergency.
Oh, well, I could help with you.
I got it, thanks.
Cool. We'll
talk later, all right?
Oh, sure, yeah, later.
I'm nearing my destination, feeling small beadlets of sweat drip from my brow. After Sorrento, I felt more nervous without someone I trust watching my back. But I try not to think about it. I take a second to compose myself before I reach it. Room 213. I grab my Beretta out of my pocket and hold it behind my back.
Housekeeping!
I'm good. Thanks. Get everything I need.
Sorry, I'm having a hard time hearing and understanding. I'm coming in to check on you.
Ma'am, I'm fine. Now if you'll please—
I use my master key to open his door and bolt in. To my surprise, I'm instantly hit in the head and my gun is yanked away from me by the eye-patched man.
Do you really think that I'm that stupid?
I was hoping you were. I kick him in the chest, but the man doesn't budge. He throws a punch at me, but I dodge it just before he makes contact. I kick up at his face and hit him dead on. He falls back on the carpeted ground, and get my gun back in the brief grace period. I point it down at him, but this time, he kicks me in the legs. I grab the wall, saving myself from hitting the floor like Stannin. He picks himself up and grabs my waist before I'm level on my feet again. I punch him again, feeling his bony jaw on my fist, but he ignores it. He tosses me to the side and I hit my head on the wooden table. I feel a little dazed, but I don't let that keep me down. I pick myself up only to be in the strong hands of Stan yet again. His hands wrap around my neck and he shoves me against the wall. I try to throw his grip off, but he's incredibly strong. I'm about to kick out at him when I'm back sailing through the air and crashing back down on the floor, right next to his bed. My body screams out at me to stop, but I know I can't. The man dives for my gun before I can and points it at me. My eyes dart around for something to throw at him, but...
I wouldn't if I were you. Now, you're gonna sit there, shut up, and let me explain what's gonna happen.
Look, if you're going to kill me, do it already. Don't waste my time.
Oh, no. That's not what I had in mind. But I won't hesitate to shoot you if you try anything. Just listen.
I'd myself relax a little, curious at what he's about to say.
Good. I need your help, Natalia Romanoff. Or would you prefer Black Widow? Your red room may be good, but we're better. Yes, I know all about you, Romanoff. All of your missions and the loss of your partner. Must have been rough, but you seem to be doing well. Remotely well. That is, considering you got your ass handed to you by a guy who has limited hand-eye coordination.
Are you going to get to the point or just ramble on?
The point is, I know how horrific most of your life has been. Made to become a killer, torture and beat people to near death, losing any innocence you had at a young age, and forced to become an adult before you're even ready. It's not an easy life to live, and you're caught in their web. You've seen what happens to anyone who tries to leave the fold. Hell, you've killed few of them yourself. What I'm offering you is a chance to break free from all of this.
Out of the goodness of your heart?
Not exactly, no. You'll be a valuable asset to my agency with your skills and training. You'll be paid your share and protected from the Red Room. I'd even allow you to pick and choose your missions, if you accept.
And if I don't, are you going to kill me?
I'd rather not, but if it has to come to that, yes. You don't have much of a choice. You either fail your mission and get executed, or you come and work for me where you'll be safe and have more freedom.
Or I kill you and continue my work for the Red Room.
And there is that. Yeah, but you have a real opportunity here. Don't throw it away.
I take a second to think it over, weighing all my outcomes in my head. When I was a little girl, I would have jumped at any chance to escape the Red Room. Perhaps I really have been brainwashed, because now part of me wanted to continue my work with the Room. Where would it lead, though? When would it all end? Was I really going to be an assassin all of my life and die out in the field? I'll do it. I'll work for your agency.
Great. Now, you better not just be saying that to put me at ease so you can kill me.
That is tempting. Stannin lowers my gun and helps me off the floor.
Nicholas Fury, Director of S.H.I.E.L.D. So, do you prefer Natalia or...
Natasha. My mother used to call me that.
Natasha it is.
When do I get started?
Funny you should mention that. I've actually got something right up your alley, if you're ready.
No sense in wasting time. Fury walks over to the closet, opening the door and grabbing a briefcase from the top. He opens it and pulls out a file and flips through it, before handing it to me. On the front is some sort of red symbol, an octopus. I begin thumbing through the information inside.
Hydra's been a thorn in the world's side for decades now. We thought they vanished with the end of the Third Reach, but... then my agency got wind of their return back in the 80s. We thought they were finally snuffed out back in 87, but we recently started seeing the signs again. These bastards are like an unkillable weed. We put one of our agents on the inside, but we haven't heard from him in weeks. We fear the worst.
So now you want me to go undercover, right?
Exactly. With your reputation, they'll definitely have an interest in you. Getting in will be difficult, though. The entrance examination is an assassination of a high-value target. We have a target in mind already. You won't be actually killing him, but we'll make sure it's convincing.
And who is this target?
Oh, only the U.S. Secretary of State.
Only.
Oh my God, Jerry! Jerry, no! He's dead! Someone murdered him!
Ma'am, get down!
I didn't bother sticking around to see my handiwork. I ran out from my hiding spot, knowing that I didn't have much time before security found me. I left my sniper behind, being careful not to leave any fingerprints behind, because Hydra certainly wouldn't want to work with me if I was America's most wanted. Once I get out in the open, I do my best to blend in with the panicked mob, fleeing the scene. Fury and I figured that the security at the Secretary of State rally couldn't handle this, and we were right. As I make my way towards the exit, I bump into an average man in a suit. I think nothing of it at the moment, but my only concern is not getting caught by the drove of security officers frantically searching the area. I make my escape with ease. No one seems to pay me any mind. Once I'm outside and a ways away from the building, I realize there's a note in my pocket. It's an address. 1104 Alden Street, back alley, 11:11 p.m. Looks like I've got a date. Naturally, I arrive a few hours to scope out the place, checking for spots where I can make fast exits, in areas that could be sniper dens. The location seems secure enough and casual, but I'm armed and prepared for any tricks. As I continue scanning the area, I hear footsteps draw near. I put a hand on the butt of my gun and turn to face them. The source of footsteps is a black trench-coated man with a hat almost obscuring his eyes. I can tell by the way he's walking that he's carrying, which is to be expected. He stops in his tracks, a little ways away from me, and motions me to follow him. I look around first, making sure no one is watching me, and then join him. He takes me down a few side streets and alleyways, each darker and more ominous than the last. He doesn't bother telling me where we're going, or even if he's my guy. Blind trust it is, then. We reach a door and the man stops. He looks at me for a second before knocking a few times on it. The door swings open, seemingly done by no one but the wind. The man steps to the side and motions me to enter in the dark abyss of the hallway. I go in, feeling a cool air dance on my skin and give me goosebumps. My steps echo around the passageway, and my eyes look around for any forms of life. Down at the end of the corridor, a red light is flicked on, and a bald man with a monocle is now in sight, with a seemingly kind smile.
Miss Romanoff, I am a fan of your work. I've been following it since your mission in Morocco. We have been considering snatching you away from the Red Room, but we're glad to have seen you take the initiative to come to us instead. I must say, I was quite impressed with your performance in our entrance exam.
Thank you, Mr.
Baron. Baron von Straka. We have one more task to test your loyalty before we welcome you officially to Hydra. If you would follow me, please, Miss Romanoff.
He turns to the left and opens up a previous hidden door. I follow him in without question, and he turns on the only light in the room. In the center of the blank gray room is a man tied to a chair. Starker kicks the chair, and he jolts awake. Cuts and bruises riddle his face, and probably all around his body too. His eyes shoot from Strucker to me, looking a little confused by my arrival.
This, my dear Miss Romanoff, is Harold Armstrong. He was placed in my organization as an undercover sleeper agent, reporting back to American intelligence agency, SHIELD. He thought he was so clever, disguising his relays and reports back to his base. We intercepted them months ago, and gave him false information to lead SHIELD away from us. What does he have to do with you, you may be wondering? You're going to end his miserable life. I assume you're armed, ja?
I nod.
Good, good. Nadia, you do this, and you are officially a member of Hydra.
Engstrom's eyes widen when he realizes that he's reaching his end. I unholster my pistol and point it at his head. His eyes close and tears slips out.
I didn't think about his life when I pulled the trigger. Only that he was a task and my goal. And that is what needed to be done. Blood rushed out of the newly formed wound, and he was gone from this world. Strucker claps at the morbid scene.
I will show you to your quarters and prepare you for your initiation ceremony. Welcome, the Hydra, Natalia. Cut off one head. Two more shall take its place. Natalia, Villanova.
My life has never been in my hands. I've always been used by forces more powerful than myself. My father, Mistress Belova, and now I'm divided evenly between Fury and Strucker. All the horrible things I've had to do travel with me wherever I go. But I never allow the nightmares to get to me. I'm no hero. But maybe one day I'll finally do something for the betterment of the world. That day isn't today, though. Today, I'm still the monster I was raised to be. And today, I fly Hydra's flag. Hail Hydra!
Is there any room in advance?
I set the book that I was reading in my quarters down and get out of my bed. I take my pistol off my nightstand, feeling its familiar weight in my hand, before sliding it into my pocket. Just in case, Sharker wants me to execute another spy. Once I'm ready, I exit my living quarters and walk into the ready room. Hydra's base in London is rather plain, but more interesting than the Red Room's facilities. The walls are a slate color, and everything is well lit and clean daily. I pass by a few of the training rooms, hearing the thumps of new recruits practicing. It doesn't take long before I reach the ready room, which currently has most of its lights turned off. I step in and close the door behind me. Strucker glides out of the shadows to greet me.
Miss Romanoff, you have proven yourself to be trusted these past 2 years. With monumental success, you have given Hydra. We wish to inform you on our primary mission.
Wait. A man steps out from the shadows. Though I've never met him before, I've heard the horror stories tied to the intimidating purple-masked man.
Miss Romanoff, what do you know about the Tesseract?
Baron Zemo himself.